You ain't never should have come around these parts. You're a city fella, aren't you?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I didn't know I was going to... I thought I was benevolent and kind, and this was a team. I thought we were a team. Now they want in on it.
Well, you know, people glom on to success.
You can't do double takes. Nobody sees it.
Okay. People glom on to success.
There you go. Yeah, joining us from Kennebunk, Maine, is an Emmy and Peabody Award-winning comedy writer, the great Jim Earl. And Dan just bought your book. Somebody else suggested Tom Weber from the COVID Players, great singer. I believe at Office Hours, he was the one who suggested that you should be doing obituaries for people who are not dead physically, but dead spiritually.
Well, I've done a few obituaries of people who I'd like to see dead. I've done future obituaries, and yeah. I haven't done Herman Cain yet.
Were you upset to find out that we lost him?
No, and I wasn't surprised either.
Why?
Because he's an adventurous man who put his life on the line to help millions of people.
In Tulsa, get a good man elected president. Hey, Jim Earl, you went to the beach today.
No, we didn't get a chance to. We had too many other things going on, like having things delivered, medicine delivered, mix-ups with our health system, our negligent, corrupt health system, where we have like four intermediaries between the doctor and our care.
Do you want to talk about that, or should we talk about somebody in California who tweeted out, he's a friend of ours, who can't get his chemo because the pharmacy in Beverly Hills accepted his $1,500, but it wasn't approved. And he literally wrote, "If you want me to die, just tell me and I'll go away. Otherwise, let me know whether or not I can get my chemo."
Yeah. Can't mention his name. I wouldn't want to.
But he put it out on Facebook and Twitter. And I read that. And the message is, don't get sick in this country.
I think the full message is, give us your money and we won't treat you. And you can do nothing about it because you're too sick and worn out to fight the hours-long fight on the phone, going through the phone rabbit hole, and all the people telling you that, yes, I understand your situation, James. And I understand fully what you're talking about. Let me talk to my manager or the supervisor or the case manager, all these, you know. And it's, you know, say, you know, two guys and a rabbit sitting in a room somewhere in New Jersey.
Denying you the medicine you need to stay alive.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Diabetic Fury. It's an organization that your beloved, Martha, who has a Patreon account, I believe it's patreon.com/MarthaPrevent.
I don't know. You have to ask her.
Well, I don't want
to. You should get her on the show.
I don't want
to. Get her on the show. Get her on the show one day. What are you going through me?
But Diabetic Fury, I believe it's patreon.com/MarthaPrevet. I think Dan will give me the answer. It's Martha Prevet. Yes.
P-R-E.
Dan, we can't do the show without Dan.
Dan is incredible. Look at him. He's already put it down in the chat room where people talk badly about you.
And you know how I know they talk badly about me? Because you stick around.
Did I insert things in there?
Yes, you participate in the chat room.
Of course I do. I want to liven it up. These people need you need to pay attention to these people because, you know, they're
pathetic. You're using the term people very loosely, my friend.
These parasites.
Yes, thank you.
Yes. And you know, you know, you need to show them some respect. Not a lot, but some. Because it's all they live for. I mean, look, it's a Thursday night, right? This is Americans would traditionally be out doing nothing. And here they are indoors doing nothing.
These people, they come to sabotage me. They're not rooting for me. And now they're forming a union. All they do is complain and pass notes. And I hear there's been some smoking going on.
Smoking?
Did you know that? They've been smoking.
I think so. In the chat room?
I think some of them smoke that. I don't think it's tobacco. But the...
You used to get blowjobs in the chat room.
Yes. When I was able to do my trot at CBGB's. Talk to me about diabetic fury. What is it like in America trying to get your insulin? What is it like?
It's like our friend, mutual friend, trying. We have two mutual friends, by the way, who have cancer, and one of them complained to me that she didn't get enough. She didn't have a storage of cancer pills, chemo pills, or whatever. It's like you get only a certain amount for a month, and then you know. What if you go on vacation or something? Or what if you lose those? And it's the same thing with insulin. They only give you a certain amount. Every damn month, you got to go through the same calls back and forth and get another prior authorization for diabetic equipment or something. It's like, hey, you know, this is a chronic disease and it lasts a lifetime. We're not fooling you. We're not lying about having diabetes after 30 days or 60 days.
What could you do? What can insulin be used off-label for?
To kill your annoying wife.
So there's no other use for insulin other than dealing with diabetes?
Not that I know of. I could give you a shot of adrenaline or energy, I guess. But I think that's ridiculous. Or lose weight. Is that people, idiots use it to lose weight or something?
And Wilford Brimley died, and I thought of one joke. What did he die from?
Diabetes. That's what
he died at like 80?
84, I think.
Yeah. But he was 84 in the firm in 1997.
Yes.
He was old. Yeah. Huh? He's like Angela Lansbury. Like Angela Lansbury, who's still alive, thank God. She was old in The Manchurian Candidate, and that was like 1964, 65.
Yeah. I don't know what to tell you.
But weren't you shocked that Wilford Brimley was A, still alive, and B, only 84?
No, but well, a friend of mine used to know him, so she told me how young he was. So in that respect, I guess I wasn't very shocked, but I would have been had I not known that.
Yeah.
These are other boring facts from my life.
It's not. You look really great. You look rested. You didn't get to the beach.
Tomorrow, hopefully.
Yeah.
Trying to go to Goose Rocks Beach.
Well, who are you hoping that Joe Biden picks for a running mate? Because I know you're...
Sarah Palin.
Yeah. Susan Collins.
Or Sue Collins, yeah.
She's not doing well. I'm worried. What do we do if Sue Collins loses? Then we lose a bit. We lose a whole character on the show.
She'll never leave politics, though. She will always be a thorn in everyone's side, and also Sarah Gideon.
I'm Sarah Gideon.
Well, who's Sarah Gideon?
She's the one who's going to beat Susan Collins.
Oh, what does she sound like?
I'm Sarah Gideon.
Do you hear that?
Yeah.
That's what she sounds like, basically.
Okay, but I don't. But not enough people know who she is yet.
Oh, they will when Sue Collins loses.
And we have to find somebody to replace her.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Nobody will replace me. Nobody.
Are you having a good?
I'm sorry.
Are you having a good? Are you having a good summer? Are you? You look rested and relaxed. I wish I could come up and visit you, but we're not allowed out of the state.
We haven't left the apartment in 5 months.
Me, I haven't.
I haven't either. Well, I, sometimes I get on my bike and I go around the parking lot next door. I stay clear of everybody because everybody, nobody here wears a mask. They're a fucking Maine Kennebunkport bubble. Fucking idiots on the beach bringing their kids from wrestling class and running up and down and climbing all over each other like nothing's going on.
And wait a second, you haven't left? I have this image of you and Martha tooling around.
Stop there, freaking pervert.
I have an image of the two of you getting out in the sun and enjoying life up in Maine. So if I were to move to Maine, mm-hmm. I'd have to be stuck indoors as well. I thought the whole purpose of being in Maine is to be outside.
Well, we have a real nice backyard, beautiful garden. And, you know, it's you have more space, definitely, than you would anywhere in New York City, obviously. Yeah.
Yeah. So you're breathing fresh air.
Yes.
Yes. What is a typical day for Jim Earl? What time do you get up?
Well, I start choking on my vomit in my sleep. Then I roll over and I vomit again.
Mm-hmm.
And then I wake up. And
and you say to Martha, here's breakfast in bed,
breakfast
and dinner and lunch. Now clean the sheets.
Clean the sheets. Keep your mouth
joke.
Shut and don't say a word because I've had it.
Mm-hmm. Are you a stern taskmaster with her?
Absolutely not. She controls everything I do, and I do it faithfully.
What is the secret to a long-term relationship?
Always having a phone handy.
Don't make me edit anything. I want to just put this show up without having a phone call later. That joke was, I take that out.
What do you think the secret is to a long-term relationship?
What is the secret to a long-term? I think there are only 7 good years in a relationship. So the trick is to spread 7 years, but 7 times 365 over 50 years. So what is that? The 7 times, what is that? 21,000, 22,000 days? I think a good relationship has about 22,000 good days. So you got to sprinkle it over a 50-year relationship and then spend the rest of the time away from one another.
But there are couples who live with each other for 50, 60 years and they love every minute of it. They stay together and they can't, you know, they love
it. They can't be separated.
Yeah, they're like twins.
Yeah. And you don't think that's sick? You don't think one of them is being held hostage by the other?
No. What about the Siamese twins? Or what about twins who stay with each other for life?
That's true. That's true. They refuse to. Yeah. Don't go there.
I was born.
No, don't.
Connected with my brother at my asshole.
That means
we shit into each other.
Don't do that.
That's an old Johnny Carson roast joke.
Really?
Yeah, his head writer said that about him.
But Johnny was born?
With connected connected to his brother by through his asshole, something like that. Wow. And the punchline was they crapped into each other.
They're jokes. You know, they run Carson on Antenna TV. I haven't seen it in years, but there's some jokes that they cannot possibly, unless they do it, unless they timestamp it, there are jokes that you can never get away with that Carson would do.
The Tea Time movie was the best. I still laugh at that. The Tea Time movies were always hysterical to me.
Yeah, very happy man. People who worked for Johnny only had nice things to say about the set. And everybody was very happy working for him. He was very warm.
I can't tell you. Are you serious? You're not serious.
He's a kind man.
Really?
Oh, my God. Very giving. And now they're going after Ellen, and her brother had to come to her defense. It's poor Ellen.
Well, you know, people are bullying her, basically.
Yeah, they're not being kind.
Yeah.
They're not being kind.
She's got a lot of problems with, deciding where to distribute her money. $100 million.
No, $350 million.
$350 million?
That's what I just read, yeah. Jay Leno came to her defense?
Yeah.
He says he's not. I'm not going to let hearsay ruin a friendship. I'm not going to let hearsay. I'm not going to let 70 people ruin a friendship. 70 people have come forward and said it's a.
Yeah, hearsay. It's not hearsay if it's eyewitnesses. These are the people who are saying it. It's not hearsay. These are the employees.
What do you think is going on? Because who cares? In terms of Warner Brothers, which owns the show, something else is going on because every workplace is toxic. Why Ellen? Why now? Why aren't they just writing checks quietly with NDAs? What's going on? Is Warner Brothers trying to cancel Ellen because it's not making the money it once used to, and there's like a morals clause or something that they want to get out of?
I don't think they'll ever cancel her. I don't think they make too much money off of her.
Do they, though? She's making a lot of money. Why wouldn't Warner do a better job? You know, they have new management. They have AT&T. Mr. Stanky from AT&T, I believe, runs Ellen's show now. Is it conceivable that an edict has come down? That's what I've heard, that if you work for Mr. Stanky, you have to show profits. If you're not profitable, you're done. Is it conceivable that Ellen has gotten to the point where she's more expensive and it's not worth it, and the only way out is to take some accusations, all legitimate, I'm sure, and conduct an investigation that destroys the brand so they can get out of the contract with her? Do you think it's an internal sabotage?
Well, she's not making them enough money, I guess so. But I can't conceive of her not making anybody money.
Is anybody making money right now?
Her employees, you know.
Right.
That's what you asked, who cares earlier. Well, I care. I cared when I was outside her show picketing during the writer's strike.
Mm-hmm.
I cared when they fired Karen Kilgariff.
For
walking the picket line.
And Ellen is anti-union?
Well, she must be. She was scabbing during the fucking strike. And that's dangerous. You know, when you have people like that, when you have people like Jon Stewart and even Letterman and just everybody who went back to work, the hosts, claiming that, well, I'm not a writer. Really? You're writing, you're creating material there during a writer's strike. And for them to do that is not only anti-union, it's also dangerous. It's dangerous for the strikers, because the strikers are out there on the streets risking their lives, basically. Because, for instance, on the first hour of the first day of the writer's strike, our head writer was hit by a car, run over by a scab. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, people are angry because of the strike, and we're angry because we're striking because we aren't getting enough money, and the job market is horrible, and we're treated horribly in show business. Show business is the wild, wild west when it comes to workers' rights. You can say anything, do anything. We used to be able to in a work environment, and nobody would dare complain. Nobody would dare complain about the working conditions or the hours or the lack of health care, because everybody wants to be a writer. And so nobody has a spine. Nobody will ever complain. The ones that do are blacklisted.
Mm-hmm.
Contracts aren't renewed, or they're suddenly gone over the weekend. Hey, what happened to so-and-so?
That's right. You know that there's a service now that does a psychological profile of employees to determine who is most likely to want to unionize?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, there's a new service. I'm serious.
Really?
That companies can now hire consultants to surveil the workplace and identify the ones most likely to be pro-union.
Is there a name of this company? Is it one company, or is it?
I have to look it up, but yeah, I mean, this country is so anti-union. So Ellen, from what we've heard, it was a toxic work environment. There was some illegalities. There was, you know, guys grabbing other guys, other women, but she's not named. Nobody accuses her of doing anything other than maybe laughing at one of the producers berating the staff. Right?
As far as I've read, yes.
But the fish, so
you're responsible for your show. You create the environment. You're the head of the show.
Do you believe that she's crying and upset? She's got $350 million.
Yes, I do.
You think that she, I don't know. I can't imagine what that life is like. So I don't know. I mean,
I'm sure she thinks she's a victim. These people always do. Jon Stewart did.
He did? He thought he was a victim?
Yes.
Explain.
It's always a personal thing. You know, the head writer whom he hired, after learning that some of the writers were talking to the Writers Guild to unionize, he came in and practically with tears in his eyes and said, "How could you betray John?"
Hmm.
That kind of shit. It's a sickness. You know, it's a Stockholm syndrome. People want to please the dictator, and
if you're frightened, and if you need the money, and you need the work, you're gonna get along to.
Yes.
You're gonna go along to get along, right?
And you'll scab. You'll do anything.
What's the answer then?
The answer is to unionize the whole country from the ground up.
But how can we do that when there are people like you who think they're better than others?
Well,
I'm being serious. How can I have solidarity with somebody like you who's hyper-educated, condescending, snarky? Why should I have, I'm being serious.
You left out handsome.
And handsome. How am I going to have solidarity with people who look down on me?
I had solidarity with the writers that I worked with. It's just that nobody wants to take a stand when times get hard.
But don't you think the problem in this country is we're competitive and we hate each other? I'm being serious.
Well, we're
Schadenfreude. We're fueled, at least in Hollywood. You'd rather see your friend fail than do well. Right?
No.
There's a big dose of Schadenfreude.
Well, if you're talking about seeing somebody go on stage and really bomb badly, that can be funny. That can be very, very fun to watch and be very funny, because it's not the end of the world, and they're funny anyway.
All right, Dave Cyrus.
I'm sorry. I don't know anything about Dave Cyrus.
All right, he does the show. Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask now, I'm God, okay? I'm the God of Hollywood. And I sit you down, and I'm going over 2020 with you. And I say, Dave Cyrus, screenwriter, does the David Feldman show. He's going to write a screenplay directed by Judd Apatow. It's going to star Pete Davidson, Marissa Tomei, and Bill Burr.
Mm-hmm.
Are you happy about that? Be honest. You're talking to the God of show business.
I'm happy only if he can get me into there somehow.
Exactly. And he's not giving you a part. You have nothing, no skin in that game. I'm thinking of giving this to Dave Cyrus. But I can stop it if you want. Jim, I'm offering that to you. I'm the God of show business. Do you want Dave Cyrus to have a movie
made? Wait a minute. I just remember now. You took my job at Spike Ferriston.
I didn't take your job.
You replaced me.
I replaced
Spike Ferriston.
Yes, I wrote a note to Spike saying, if you want somebody who doesn't make trouble, who will work for half of what Jim charges you, I'll work longer and harder, and I won't criticize you.
You had two more Emmys than I did, and that's why they hired you. And boy, did they ever learn their lesson with that, didn't they?
Did I replace you?
Yeah, you did.
Were you, all right, so back to my question here. You have a choice. Dave Cyrus gets a movie made or he doesn't. It's up to you, yes or no?
Yes.
Why you not? Say yes.
Well, I don't know who. It's, theoretically, if I know somebody, I like them in show business and I respect their work, why, yeah.
Okay, now it's being reviewed.
That means, hey, I know somebody that I respect and like, and I'm glad he's succeeding and being successful. And also, he knows me. Maybe he'll invite me in.
Nothing in it for you. Nothing. He doesn't know you. He doesn't think about you. There's nothing in it for you. It's just him. Yes or no?
Then fuck him.
Exactly.
The hell with him.
All right. Now his movie premieres and you open up your computer, go to Rotten Tomatoes.
Yes.
I want to see how the King of Staten Island. By the way, I don't even know. I never checked out the reviews. But what would you rather see? Be honest. Rave reviews or Jon Stewart's recent reviews? Did Jon Stewart's reviews make you happy?
No, but they made me laugh. there's a difference between happiness and laughing, David. And that's the cross we comedians must bear.
Were you glad to see that Jon Stewart's movie was a disaster? Yes or no?
I was.
Did you or did you not call me panting and salivating and saying,
you're
Jon's...
Well,
that was me.
That was you.
Well, So how can we have solidarity if we're rooting against people?
I felt justification, vindication.
Weren't we going to do that? Weren't we going to do you as a movie critic?
Yes, another one, yeah.
And every movie review would go back to how horrible Jon Stewart's movie was. Why didn't you do
more
that?
More than one movie, you know.
Why doesn't didn't you
have
do
a,
that?
Doesn't he have a Netflix project or something, too? It's
I don't
endless.
Know.
I'm just saying the possibilities are endless.
The question is, how do we have solidarity in America if we're not rooting for one another? That's my question.
Well, the competition is always out there, Dave, in show business, especially among comedians. You can't help the competition and the show.
And so there's no comedian. So there's no comedians union.
There should be a comedians union.
But we compete against one another.
There should be a show business, just a blanket show business union.
Mm-hmm.
People in the writers union. People shouldn't be
competing
and having to pay for auditions.
So the Emmys, the Peabodys, the Academy Awards, reviews from impotent, flatulent, morbidly obese, stubby-fingered losers. It's all there to keep us fighting amongst each other instead of going after Louis B. Mayer. That's why Louis B. Mayer invented the Academy Awards. To divide
really?
And conquer. Yep.
Why is that?
The Academy Awards were invented to divide the workers so they wouldn't be strong and have solidarity. He was using craftsmen to build his home in Malibu, and the union stood up to him. And he said, we got to do something. Let's have an Academy Award thing where they start competing against one another. Awards are bullshit.
Is that your theory?
Well, no, that's a fact.
I thought the Academy Awards were just a way of promoting the business.
No, dividing the business. Dividing the workers. Yeah.
Well, I agree with the concept of dividing the workers. That's in every corporation, isn't it? That's in every corporate structure. This fake unity.
Yeah.
The fake PMA, the brotherhood. It's all bullshit, yeah. David, and you're part of it. You're the reason this happened. You represent everything I hate.
Thank you. That means
so
a lot.
When are you coming up?
I wish I could come up. Jim Earl, great job, as always.
I'm not leaving.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not. I'm going to keep popping in here and saying horrible
Stay
things.
Out of that chat room.
No, I'm in it right now. You're dividing us. People are complaining about Bruce Springsteen says, I can't
upside
even.
Down. Yeah, he's upside down. All right.
Upside down.
What's Jim Earl 666 is your Twitter feed?
No, I'm not leaving, Dave, because, you know, you wanted me on the show to talk about Ellen, and you're too much of a coward to really say what you want about Ellen.
What?
You had an affair with Ellen many, many years ago, and you won't even talk about it anymore.
That's
Why
true.
Is that, David?
That was a long time ago, Jim. We don't want to bring that up. Do you really want to go there?
I've wanted to go there for years, and you won't let me. It's something. Do you remember her? I remember her when she was very nice.
Okay.
On stage.
I never had a problem with her. Maybe her employees are toxic. Ever think about that? Maybe, you know, looking at her, why do they have to look at her?
I know.
Why are they? And maybe, you know, maybe people don't shower. Maybe she has a, you know, maybe sending somebody home to shower. I've had smelly workers.
Yeah, and they if they can't, don't have time to go home and shower because they're working all day, then they should spray alcohol on their body.
Do something. All right. And tell people you're nice. That's my message. Tell people you're nice.
Union, the hell with them if they want a union. What, they can't survive by themselves?
It's Ellen's fault you and I couldn't make it as stand-ups. And so we had to become writers and wanted to be protected by a union. It's her fault. Maybe had you and I worked a little harder as stand-ups, we could have run a toxic environment. It's her fault.
I think we are running a toxic environment right now.
Yes. All right. We have another guest that I have to get to. Do you want to stick
with the other guest?
What happened to solidarity?
This way, do you have respect for any human being?
I can pretend.
You're a fraud.
People know that already.
Oh.
Well, wait a second. You're my last guest.
I am?
Yeah. Bob Rubin didn't show up.
Oh.
But he never confirmed. Oh, all right. You shouldn't be drinking apple juice. Well, hang on for 1 second. One of the guests is doing a documentary on Kenya that I've been promising to talk to. Let me look for her. Are you there? Raise your hand. All right. Who would like to talk to Jim Earl? Raise your hand. Oh, this is a call from...
Ask me anything.
Ask Jim anything. This call comes to Martha Previtt, who's in Kennebunk, Maine. What is your question for Jim Earl?
Hello, David.
Hi, Martha.
I have a question for Jim.
Yes. Yes, what is your question? You're scraping the earbuds.
Jim, do you hear some feedback?
No, go. Try it again.
Jim, what's that noise? What's that noise in the background?
It sounds like a chipmunk eating some nuts inside Dave's brain. What's that? Is that feedback?
You're gaslighting me. You're gaslighting me.
Get in another room.
I hear something. Is there somebody making noise back there? Who's that talking?
Is
that David? David, I have a question for your guest.
Yeah.
Is that a squirrel?
Stop it. All I've got is this show, and you're ruining it. You're ruining the sound.
Hello, Davey.
Oh, is this? Oh, my God. It's Melania Trump.
Hello.
How are you feeling?
We're all in these together, Davey.
Yes. Thank you. How are you feeling, Melania, First Lady?
Now I show you my teats.
Oh, no, thank you. No.
Yeah.
No, Melania. No, please. Now, what kind of movies did you make? Double what?
Double DB Best?
No, Double Penna, what?
Oh, I see, baby. Yes, Double Penetration in all three holes.
Double Penetration in all three holes. Yes.
Yes, baby.
Yes, yes. And you're not you were never an escort, right?
I'm not prostitute, no.
Okay, and if I were to say you were a prostitute, what would happen?
I forget.
You would hear from your pimp. I would hear from your pimp, right?
Oh yes, you hear from my pimp.
Let's
yes.
Try that again. So okay. you were never an escort, right?
No, Davey, I was never an escort.
And if I said you were an escort, what would happen?
I tell you, you talk to my pimp.
Oh my God.
And how is what's his name? Who are you married to?
Toenail.
Toenail. Toenail.
I call him Toenail.
Toenail Trump.
Yes, Davey. Toenail. Because he looks like big yellow, thick toenail
right.
With his big hair. He reminds me of those yellow toenails.
Toenail Trump. Yes. And what is your advice to America with COVID-19? What should we remember not to do?
Don't get sick. It is a waste of time.
You're saying getting sick is a waste of time. That's
yes.
That's good.
You always wear cloth coverings?
I always wear cloth face covering.
Claw face covering.
Claw face covering. Mm. Okay. When we do video chat, Davey.
Right. Right. All right, Melania. It's good talking to you.
Well, we should probably get a call from Sarah.
Now I show you my teeth.
Oh, no, thank you. No, thank you, though. Thank you.
Okay. Probably get a call from Sarah Gideon one of these days.
Yeah, we'll take a call from her. But let's, Melania, would you like to take a call from Andrew? Let's take a call from Andrew.
Hello.
Hello, Andrew. Do you have a question?
This is Melania. For you who do not know me, I am willing to answer question. Go ahead, caller.
What is your question for the First Lady, Andrew?
Melania, thank you for being here.
Yes, Andrew. Thank you. You have question or would you like to show me your tits?
No, we don't do that. What? Yeah, we don't do that on the show.
Yes, baby, this is no video chat. Please deposit $99.
For what?
For video chat live.
For what? What?
Live video chat.
For a I have to pay you $90? $99 for a live video chat?
For first 5 minutes.
For first 5 minutes?
Yes.
Do you have a PayPal account?
Just go to Martha Previtt Patreon page.
And so I pay $99.
And be sponsored. Yes. And then I show you. I show you my teeth, yes?
Hmm. Jim, would you? This is the First Lady of the United States. I don't know. Yeah. Andrew, what is it? I'm getting hot. Andrew, what is your question for First Lady Melania?
I can hardly say anything. I'm laughing so much.
Hello, Andrew.
Melania.
So nice to hear you. Yes?
So what was your relationship with Herman Cain?
Oh, good question. Yes.
Oh, I'd like to tell you that. But as we say auf Deutsch, 999.
Hmm. No, no, no.
Ja, so, Davy, nein. Heil Hitler.
Thank you.
What?
What?
That's
does very, she know what she's saying?
That's inappropriate.
Melania, okay, let's...
Nine.
Here, Kathleen, you have a question for First Lady Melania Trump.
Oh, I do. Thank you so much. It's so lovely to hear your wonderful voice.
Oh, well, thank you, darling. It is so nice to hear from you, too.
I have a question. Can you please tell me what Rush Limbaugh smells like?
Oh, that's an interesting question. Thank you for that.
Rush Limbaugh. He smells like Ben Gay and ham and cheese grilled sandwich with provolone.
Hmm. Thank you for making my dreams come true.
You're welcome.
Now, how would you know what Rush Limbaugh smells like?
Davey, don't go there.
Because she gave him the Medal of Freedom, remember?
Oh, that's right.
She was connecting him the whole time.
Right. You gave him a necklace, right?
I gave him a necklace.
Right. Did anybody ever give you a necklace?
Yes, Davey. I have many a necklace.
Any?
But my favorite ones are, you know, the pearl necklace.
The pearl necklace.
Do they have
yes, Davey.
Do you have any earrings?
Yes, I have pearl earrings, too.
Oh, yes. They must look beautiful on you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your
I am model. I am not prostitute.
Oh, no.
No. Kathleen, you can't call her a prostitute.
No.
My pimp get very upset when he hear people call me prostitute. He said I'm going to beat them up. Mm. And I don't want no trouble.
You don't want trouble.
No.
You're a genius.
Thank you, Davey.
Yeah, let's go to...
I am First Lady, for you who do not know me.
Yes, of course. Let's go to Lance. You have a question for the First Lady?
Madam First Lady, it is so good to talk to you. I'm such a big fan. I want to know, your son Baron will be having an excellent quality education at his private school, delivered virtually. What sort of education should the other students in this country have this year?
Well, that's a good question. Yes. And by the way, what is your son's name? I kind of
Barton.
Missed. Barton. Barson?
Barton.
Barton is the, he's your son with whom?
With my illegitimate son, Barton.
Barton. You, and yes, do we know who the father is?
I don't know. Maybe we do show. We go on show and we find out, we do DNA tests. They do that in America. What is it, Mori Povich?
Right.
Yes. Yeah.
But we would need some DNA.
Oh, yes. We get a Barton DNA. You spit in a cup.
He would what?
You spit in a cup.
He spit in a cup. And how would we get your DNA?
Well, Davy, get your mind out of the sewer gutters.
Oh. I apologize, Madam First Lady. Let's go to Pete. You have a question for First Lady Melania
Trump.
I am
not a prostitute.
No, I didn't say you were. I did not say that. You have a question, Pete, for First Lady?
Well yes, I do. you know, I'm on Facebook friends with your friend Martha. Is Martha your friend, Martha Previtt?
Oh, yes. Martha is very nice young lady. Yeah,
she is. Well, I disagree with David. I do want to see your teeth. Can you accommodate me, please?
Okay, see, this is the First Lady of the United States.
She offered, David, she offered.
No. This is inappropriate. I apologize, Madam First Lady.
Thank you, Davy. Now I show you my teeth?
No, this is not how we do.
What the hell? Jeez, what, David?
This is not good, Jim. She's the First Lady. All right, last question.
Aren't there standards and practices?
I know. Let's do one last question.
I have never been paid for the actions of sexing, baby.
I wouldn't say you did have, would.
I only do pro boner work.
Pro boner work.
Yes, that's right. You heard me right. Pro boner work.
So that would be like being with somebody for free.
Yes, Davy.
Pro boner work. Well, I had a question. I guess we're out of questions for you. Well, thank you, Madam First Lady.
Thank you, Davy. So nice to talk to you tonight.
Say hello to everybody at the White House for me.
Yes. I really must go now, Davy.
Okay. And what's your sign-off? It's always so inspirational.
Don't get sick. It is waste of time. Be best.
Be best.
Thank you. And Heil Hitler.
No, you can't do that.
Everything was fine right up until the Heil part.
Yeah, that's...
I didn't answer a question about Barton. Young man had questioned about Barton, and he's going back to school.
Yes, he's going back to school, right?
Yes, to the rich dickhead preparatory school for future psychopaths.
Ah, yeah. I think the Obama girls went there as well, as did
yes.
Amy Carter. Yeah.
And Snaggletooth.
Ivanka.
Yes.
Do you like Ivanka?
She's a snaggletooth.
Do you feel threatened by her?
Davy, I do not go there.
Okay.
We know. Pillar one, my prenuptial agreement prohibit me from speaking about snaggletooth.
Okay. Thank you, Melania.
Thank you, Davy. remember, don't get sick. It is waste of time.
Thank you.
Be best. Thank you. And Heil Hitler.
Oh, geez.
This is not good, Jim. It's not good.
Always ends that way.
It's just terrible.
I am not prostitute.
Oh, okay. That's okay. A better way. No,
yeah, you're not.
Yeah.
I would. How do you know, by the way, that you're not?
My pimp will kill you.
Okay. Thank you, Melania. Thank you.
Thank you, Davey.
Okay.
Wow. That was intense.
Yeah, she needs to be rescued. Thank you, Jim.
Okay. I'll see you in court.
All right. And don't get sick.
Be best.
Heil Hitler.
Woo!
That's a show. All right. Thank you, Stinky McGurk. We're done. I have a feeling August is going to be a lot like this. I have a feeling everybody is on vacation. I have a feeling. Oh, that was great. That was great. All right. We'll wrap it up. Let me wrap up the show. Let me mute everybody. What? What's going on? Who's that?
That's you, Collins.